Welcome to episode 17. This is a special episode. Today we are building a vehicle computer. Why are we doing this? Because it's cool. Now, we are going to be doing some coding, so we need to look the part first. Okay, that's better. So, what are we building and what does it need to do? It needs to fulfill a few requirements. So, the first thing is it needs to have GPS tracking built in. It needs to have some sort of connection to the vehicle alarm that we've already installed. It needs to control the door sensor sensitivity so we don't get any false alarms. We want to be able to remotely control the central locking using Siri. We also want to use Siri to control the internal lights of the vehicle. It's got to have a wireless hotspot. The car doesn't have a working fuel gauge, so we are going to be building a fuel gauge into this device. It's also going to have a CCTV camera and the ability to email any images that it takes and also have a sensor built in to detect movement. It needs to be low power, it needs to be low noise. And we're going to be using the following sort of technology. It's going to be based around a Raspberry Pi. It's going to also have an Arduino. It's going to have a GPS module. It's going to have RF transmitters, RF receiver. It's going to be using relays, voltage dividers. We're going to be coding in Arduino code, Python, PHP, MySQL. It's going to use Apple HomeKit. It's obviously going to have a camera built into it and a PIR sensor. And we're going to use iOS push notifications as well. So if none of that stuff interests you, stop watching now. If that does interest you, we can continue. This was the first time I ever built anything like this before, so the first stage was to put together a little test rig and check it actually does what it's supposed to do. This involved simply mounting the Raspberry Pi on a board with some cable ties. The relay is to receive a signal from the car alarm. When the alarm siren is sounding, the relay is going to switch on. The power source I'm using is simply a 12 volt to USB car adapter, and the whole lot is assembled on some 12 millimeter plywood. Here I'm using a splicing connector just to tap the pink wire, which is the 12 volt output from the alarm to the siren. And then it's a quick test just to check the Pi boots up, and that's the test board installed. So now that we know the test board is working, everything's doing what it should be doing, we now need to put together our design for the device. And we need to decide how everything's going to work. The best way to do that is to produce a schematic. This is going to give us all the wiring for the entire system and how each component is going to communicate with each other. We do that using some free software called Fritzing. You can get it for Mac, Windows, Linux, anything. It's open source and it's got most of the components on there. And if not, there's a big community and you can download extra parts that you need. So I use that to come up with the design. And this is the final finished schematic here. I'm going to put this in the description below and it's available for download. Okay, so this is the finished box. There is a lot going on, so I'm going to break it down into sections and try to explain what every component does. So on the outside, we've got a 7-inch touchscreen display. We've got a USB connection and HDMI connection there. Two screws holding everything in place. Okay, so this is inside, and I'm just going to go through and explain what's going on. So at the center of this, we've still got our Raspberry Pi. This is a Raspberry Pi 4 Model B, which is the latest version at the time of this video. I've put it in a new case, and it's also got a little cooling fan there just to stop things overheating. So at the front, we've got a high definition camera. It's got infrared LEDs there for night vision. There's its ribbon cable going in. This is the PIR sensor, passive infrared. This detects movement and activates the camera. Here's our GPS module, and that's the GPS antenna. Moving round, this is the relay that we saw before. I've just removed its inputs at the moment, but normally it would have two inputs coming in here from the siren that we connected earlier. Here we have a 433 megahertz receiver, and here we have a 433 megahertz transmitter. This is going to help us talk to the central locking of the vehicle and also the LED lights. Moving around, this is just a little PCB here with a voltage divider on there. This also has a connection here that's currently disconnected, but normally this would go to the sensor in the fuel tank. Moving around, this is the 12 volt input. We have two connections here. 12 volt from the battery DC, and it just has a surge protected USB output there, and this is what powers the Raspberry Pi and all of the other components inside. Here we have a DC to DC converter. This takes our 12 volts and puts it down to 5 volt, which is logic level, which we need for a lot of the other components. Down here we have an ADC. This is an ADS1015 analog to digital converter, which again is used as part of the fuel tank circuitry. We have a couple of connections here going outside. There's a USB drive here that is just doing a nightly backup and saving all the information from the Pi. And this USB extension cable comes outside, and on the end of it we just have our 4G dongle. So this just hides somewhere where it can get decent signal. Okay, so here's the box that I've got underneath my dash that contains the Arduino hardware. Let's take a look inside. Okay, so this is inside. It looks complicated, but I'll try to explain it in detail of every component. So on the left here, this is our input, 12 volts and ground coming in. On this side, we have our front door triggers and our rear door triggers. So these are coming in here. And the blue, this is our output that goes into the alarm. We have two voltage dividers to bring 12 volts down to 5 volts. That then goes into the analog inputs of the Arduino. The Arduino then runs code which decides whether or not the door is open or closed and sends an output here with this little diode just to protect it with this blue wire, and that goes into the alarm system. Okay, so we're going to do a test now. I've just lined it up so you can see the LED. That's our LED there, which is attached to input number 11, I believe. So I'm going to open the door. 5 seconds, the LED goes out and I close the door and it comes straight back on. So because it's waiting for the door to be open for 5 seconds, it's eliminating any false positives. Okay, so here we've got our Arduino sketch. I'm not going to go into too much detail because it's a very, very simple script. Here at the top, we've got all our variables. This is our setup here where we just set up our serial connection and which port we're going to be using, which was pin 13, as I mentioned earlier. And here's our loop. So here we're going to be reading the values. And basically here, if the input is low for more than 5 seconds, then we're going to get an output is low and it's going to write that to the digital pin. Otherwise, it's going to keep the output high. And that's it. Okay, first thing to do is open up Terminal on the Raspberry Pi and use pip to install the Python Raspberry Pi GPIO module. Next, we head over to pushbullet.com and sign up for a free account and make a note of our API key. Then we'll set up a new Python script and we'll import some modules. We're going to need OS, requests, JSON, SMTP lib, time and sleep, and most importantly, GPIO from the Raspberry Pi library. We'll set up a timer just to allow network to come to life. And we'll set up our SMTP parameters. I'm using Gmail, but obviously you would put in your own credentials. Now we put in our Pushbullet API key from the account we signed up earlier. And set up the function for the push notification. We're going to be using the HTTP requests. We're going to make a post request to the Pushbullet server. Now we can set up our GPIO. We're using pin number 15. So we're going to set 15 as an input. And now we'll set up our loop. So if the input is high for more than 5 seconds, it's going to trigger the alarm. And then it's going to send a push notification and it's going to send an email. And that's it for this script. We'll save that and test that out. Okay, let's try and steal the car and see what happens. Firstly, I set the alarm. So the car is now alarmed. And now we're going to try and start the car without turning off the alarm system. So the first stage for our GPS script is to set up a MySQL database. This is the structure here, and I'll put the SQL for that in the downloads below. It's basically a table with four columns, an ID that auto-increments, a timestamp, and longitude and latitude. Next, we use Terminal and apt to install the GPSD client libraries for Python. And now we use apt again to install the MySQL connector for Python. Okay, this is our Python GPS script. We're going to import a few modules. We're going to need OS, GPS, of course, time, threading, MySQL connector, and date time. We'll set a little timer just to allow the network to come to life. And then we will define our MySQL connection credentials. You can obviously replace these with your server logins. Now we set up our GPS daemon. And now we set up our class for the GPS poller. It's going to initialize the function. And here's our function with our loop. So our while loop is going to run when the longitude or latitude is not null. So
that we don't get empty rows in our MySQL database and mess up our map. We use the OS system clear command just to clear the terminal every time. And it's going to print on screen the latitude and longitude. And here we execute our SQL command that's going to insert this information into our location table. I'm going to close the connection and give a successful message when it's complete. Then we'll set a timer, and this is going to be the length of time between our loop. And we'll just catch a lot of exceptions here because we could occasionally get some errors and we don't want that to interfere with the running of the script. You would obviously replace this path with the path to your script wherever you've stored it on your Pi. And if there's any error, it's just going to start the script again, and this will continue until infinity. And if we detect a keyboard key, we can kill the script. I'm going to use SSH to log into the Pi, and we are going to run the Python script that we just made. A little pause while it waits for the network to come to life. And here we go. So on the screen, we're getting our GPS coordinates and a message that's saying record inserted successfully into location tables. So it's taking the coordinates and it's putting them into our MySQL database every few seconds.
Okay, so this is great. So far, we've managed to build a Python script. It's receiving our GPS data correctly and it's putting it into a database. So we've got all these GPS coordinates, the whole history. What can we do with it? So the next step is to build a web application that can grab all this information from the database and plot it onto a map. So I'm not going to go into how I've made it. I'm going to make the script available for download, but it's written in PHP and it uses the Google Maps API to plot all the coordinate data onto a map. So I'll log into that here and you can see how I'm doing it. I've stored this on my server. I'm logging in and here you can see it gives a map with a blue line that shows the vehicle's history and it tracks all its movements. And below that, it shows the raw data if you want to go into there and check the exact coordinates. Okay, we are back to my favorite subject, security. So how are we going to protect the van? Well, we have got a camera built into our computer, and we are going to use that to take photos of any intruders. We have the PIR, the passive infrared sensor. This is going to detect movement. It's going to go high or low, depending on if it's detecting movement or not. We're going to take that signal. We're going to feed it into the GPIO pins on the Raspberry Pi. As soon as we detect that, we are going to tell the camera to take a photo. We're going to take that photo. We are going to send it in an email straight away to the inbox of my choice. Very, very simple, but very effective, and it all happens very quickly. So let's get into it now. So here we go with the same routine as before. We're setting up our Python script and we're importing all our modules. I'm going to be using the Pi camera module from the official library. Standard stuff, we need SMTP libs, Raspberry Pi GPIO. These are all the email modules. And here we go, we set up our parameters. These are obviously going to be replaced with your email address, your password, and the destination, the recipient. This is the database here for all the images that the camera is going to take. The prefixes, and here's the GPIO pin setup. We're using pin 11, setting it as an input. We set a sleep timer and start defining our sending mail function. It's going to come up on the screen with sending email, and it's going to start making our directory if it doesn't exist. Here we are going to come up with a naming scheme. It's going to be using a series of numbers based on the date and the time. I'm rotating my picture 180 degrees because my camera's mounted upside down, but obviously you might not be doing that. Here we're going to set a background, and I'm also going to annotate every image with the current date and time to give it a little timestamp. Obviously it helps with identification. Then we sleep for 10 seconds and it's going to output that photo to the file name we've defined above. If you've got preview running, you can stop that there, but that's totally optional. This next process sets up our email.
Now we attach the image and define our SMTP server and begin to send the message. We set up a handshake if it's encrypted, send the mail, and then quit that connection. Here's our while loop. If the input is detected as low, it's coming up on the screen with no intruders. If it's coming up as high, it's going to come up with intruder detected, and then it's going to call the send mail function. So here we've got the computer in position. We've loaded the camera scripts. So now I'm going to leave the vehicle and enter the vehicle, and we'll see what happens. There we go, it's detected me and now it's sending the email. We are on to the next part of this build. Here's the issue. This vehicle did not come with a working fuel gauge. I took out the instrument cluster and I looked behind it. There was no cable going from the cluster to the fuel tank. Somewhere the line has been broken and I didn't have the wiring diagram from the car to work out how to fix this. I could take it to an auto electrician and it would cost about $1,000 Australian to have that sorted, or I could come up with another solution. So I got under the car and I had a look, and above the fuel tank I saw two wires. This looked like it was the two sensor cables from the fuel sender unit. How did I work this out? I took the two wires, I stuck them on a multimeter, and I put it to ohm meter, so it's going to measure resistance. I then added fuel into the fuel tank, and sure enough, the resistance value changed. So this is telling me that this vehicle has a variable resistor inside the fuel tank, and as the float moves up and down, as the fuel level increases and decreases, the resistance of that variable resistor changes, and I can use that to make my own fuel gauge. So how do we do that? We have to basically build an ohm meter. We need to take a voltage, we need to pass it through the fuel tank's variable resistor, and we need to measure a change in voltage as the fuel level increases and decreases. We measure that voltage change with our analog to digital converter. We take that analog signal, we digitize it, and then we send that to the Raspberry Pi. We're then going to write again another Python script that's going to interpret that information, and it's going to project a fuel gauge onto the desktop background of the Raspberry Pi. It's also going to upload that information to a PHP script that's going to be hosted in the cloud so that we can get that information on my iPhone or whatever while I'm driving. So we need to make a couple of image files which I'll put for download. This is a blank background of a gauge and this is a needle. Overlay one on top of the other and you get the idea. And we're going to start our script as always by importing some modules. We're going to need time, board, bus IO, the Adafruit library that's downloadable from their website for the ADC. We're going to use the Pillow library to manipulate images, OS and requests. Set a timer to let things come to life. I2C is the protocol we're using to communicate with the ADC. And here's our while loop. So this is going to take our data from the fuel tank. I needed to take an empty fuel tank figure and a full tank figure, so I had to calibrate this myself, and this is how I got these numbers. And this is just going to print the percentage remaining on the screen. And here's where we also set our path for our file name for the gauge image. These are the coordinates for the center bottom of the needle, so this is going to help us rotate the needle depending on whatever the percentage is. And now we use the Pillow library to perform a rotation on the needle image. And we're now going to paste that image on top to produce a composite and output that to a file. Now we're going to open that file again. And we're going to overlay some text on top of the entire composite image, and that's just going to be a title that says fuel remaining, and it's going to put our fuel figure in there. Once that's saved to a file, we're going to perform a system command, which is going to set the desktop background on Raspbian to our fuel gauge image, and it's going to center that in the middle. Now we just need to make a post request to our PHP script. Obviously, you would replace that URL with your own URL. And once it's made that request, it's updated online. We set a sleep timer, and that's the end of it. Hey Siri, how's my fuel level?
Your shortcut says your fuel level is 51%.
Okay, so now we want to remote control this car using Siri. We want to basically use home automation, but in a vehicle. Let's say you're locked out of the car and you've left your key inside. How do you get in? We can use Siri to do that. If I want to control the lights without using the remote, we can use Siri to do that. We need a few things. We need to interface with Apple HomeKit. Now, to do that, we use a server, an open source server called Homebridge. We download that and install that on our Raspberry Pi. And here it is running, and we install a couple of plugins. We need a plugin that emulates a garage door and a plugin that emulates a switch. And these are just going to run shell commands on our Raspberry Pi. So all I need to do is set up some shell scripts. They're going to call this Python script, and they're going to pass in some arguments, the protocol, the pulse length, and of course the code. The code is what is going to open the doors or switch on the lights or switch off the lights. Okay, so here's the situation. You've locked yourself out of the car. Let's try and get in just using my watch. Hey Siri, unlock Don Vito. And we're in. Hey Siri, switch on ceiling lights.
Understood. Request sent.
Hey Siri, switch off ceiling lights.
I've sent the request.
Hey Siri, switch on ceiling lights.
Understood. Request sent.
Hey Siri, make it romantic.